It is camp meeting time here at the Loma Linda University Church, and it has been pretty busy, especially in the media department.
And that's right. We've been working on the film for this year, and it's been a lot of work. We have a great theme this year, the song, Relational Wisdom from the Hottest Book in the Bible. As you might imagine, Joelle, it was a little challenging to figure out what story we would tell. So with that in mind, we're doing it a little differently. We're not showing a clip each and every week, but on the last weekend for Vespers, we're gonna show larger clips of the entire material. So many of you have come out and helped us, whether it's cooking food, extras, staying long hours. We really appreciate it, and you can look forward to some great clips.
Today we have our very special friends, the Heritage Singers. You will hear them shortly in the worship service. They will also be giving a special concert this evening at 7 o'clock right here in the sanctuary. We invite you all to come and hear them again.
That's right, and we want to remind them that after the concert, there's a watermelon feed out on the lawn. Also, Pastor Doug and his team is going to be selling corn dogs and all kinds of great stuff. That's going to go towards the new building. So the concert at 7, and after the concert, watermelon and corn dogs and some great time to hang out together.
We also want to let you know about a very special opportunity for all of you individuals that have adult children. Anita Roberts is going to be leading out in a very special time at 10:30 every Sabbath morning. This is an opportunity for you to pray for your adult children. It's actually called the Power of Praying for Your Adult Children. This is a time when you can talk about the concerns and just learn how to pray for them.
Then we want to talk about next week. We have a special guest coming, Celeste Holbrook, a sexologist. Now, Joelle, some people is like, what in the world? Well, we know we live in a very sexualized society, and it's a very important part of our lives. She's going to talk about things that are relevant to married couples, to singles, to parents that want to make sure their children have healthy views of sex in such a sexualized world. She's going to be doing a special presentation Sabbath afternoon, and then she has some on Sunday as well.
She does. She will be down at Damaso Amphitheater. You can find out all the details in your bulletin. There's an insert there. But we want to be sure to let you know that all of the seminars and presentations that happen on Sunday down in Damaso will have childcare provided for you. So we hope that helps and encourages you to come on out.
And then the next weekend, August 19, we have Name That Hymn. It was such a big hit last year in camp meeting. We decided to do it again this year, led by Pastor Doug Mace.
And following that, at 7 o'clock down at Drayson Center, we will be having some fun. And later during the welcome, Pastor Roy will be sharing some details about that.
Then the following weekend, August 26 at 7 p.m., is the group Veritas. Now, they'll be singing for our worship services, so you get to experience them. Now, some of you may not be familiar with them, so here, take a look. Now, many of you went to the Sandy Patty concert. This is the same group that opened for her concert. They're a powerful singing group, but you need to get tickets and you need to get them soon. You can go to our website for more information about that. That's August 26, Veritas.
That's it for announcements today. We have mentioned many things that are happening over the next month for camp meeting. If you want more information, remember we have a church app, our church website with a specific camp meeting banner that you can click on that will give you all of the details. Also, check out your church bulletin, and we are in the foyer as well at the UConnect Center, and we would be more than happy to answer any questions that you may have.
And with that, on behalf of the entire pastoral staff and all the staff and volunteers that make camp meeting possible, we hope you have a wonderful Sabbath and a wonderful camp meeting.
when the road is rough and long, and I feel so all alone, when my strength is all gone, and I can't carry on, that's when my Jesus is all that I need.
Good morning and welcome to the Loma Linda University Church.
We're absolutely delighted that you're worshiping with us during this camp meeting season. And we also want to say a great big welcome to those of you who are watching via the broadcast, our extended family members. We welcome you to camp meeting. Are you boys ready to worship?
Yep, but I have one question for you, Colton.
What's that?
Why is your Bible so small?
Well, my mom didn't think that I could handle Song of Solomon, so she took it out.
So that's why your Bible is so small?
Yep.
Well, don't worry about it, boys, because Pastor Randy is covering the Song of Solomon for 5 weekends, so you won't miss out at all. We're delighted that that you're not only here, but we want to make sure that you know some exciting things that are happening during these 5 weekends, and especially a couple of weekends we want to highlight this morning. Tonight, we want to make sure that you come back at 7 p.m. You might want to come back a little earlier to get a good seat, but 7 p.m., the Heritage Singers will be performing a full concert for us tonight. It's a great chance for you to invite your family, to invite your neighbors, to invite your friends, to make some friends this afternoon just so you can invite to tonight's concert. You want to be here. And then right after, we invite you to not only spend some time with the Heritage Singers, but also to join us on the North Lawn, just to your right, for some watermelon. All the pastors are going to be there cutting up watermelon and cutting up with you, and we want you there. And so make sure that you plan on staying by a little bit longer so we can enjoy some family time with you as well. Now, on the 19th, we have our family fun night at the Drayson Center, and many of you will recall this last year, our friends from the neighborhood took us on in a challenge, in the belly ball challenge between the pastors, and we met with them a couple of weeks ago in the morning, and they have a message for us, and I want to turn your attention to the screen to see what's going to happen on the evening of the 19th.
Hey, pastors, we can't wait for camp meeting.
So obviously on August 20, we're going to have a search committee for several pastors who will need to be replaced after that evening. So we invite you to come on out for a fun time, not only with our church family, but also with our firefighter family as well from the local community. Today, we just desire more than anything that you will enjoy a moment of worship. And so today, we invite you to enter into a mind of worship. Welcome this morning to worship.
I don't know about you, but I have been looking forward to camp meeting. How many have been looking forward to camp meeting, where we sing a little bit longer? We have very special programming, and the Lord will be glorified this morning. Won't you sing with us? You'll know all of these songs. Raise your voices as we join them with the angels.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Amen. I was sinking deep in sin. Sing with us.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Every demon stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me. Completely saves. He will lift you by His love out of the angry waves. But the master of the sea billows His will obey. He, your Savior, wants to to be your Savior.
Join along, sing out.
Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Amen. Oh, you sound so good. How many had a really good week this week? It was warm, but a good week. Okay, put them down. How many had a tough week? Tough week. When I have a tough week, I drop to my knees and I ask the Lord to be with me. Also when I have a good week. But I need Him. And when Jesus enters in, He lifts my spirit. He reminds me of my blessings. Today, friends, we sing about Jesus who lifts us up. And we reside with Him in the heavens. And He resides and abides in us. Sing with us, Jesus lifted me.
Well, I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me.
All right, friends, we want you to do something with us. Won't you stand up right now and shake the hand of the person right behind you, right next to you? We're going to make a big church seem a little smaller as we keep singing. And it's okay if you want to put your hands together. Let's sing together.
Well, I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me.
Well,
when I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. When I was in trouble, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, singing glory, hallelujah, singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me.
Let's give the Lord a big hand. You may be seated.
Good morning. The scripture reading this morning is from the book Song of Songs, otherwise known as Song of Solomon. I'll be reading from chapter 2, verses 3 through 13. Again, that's Song of Songs, or Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verses 3 through 13. If you'd like to follow along in your pew Bibles, you'll find the passage on page 1010. Again, in the pew Bibles, it's page 1010. And it reads, "Like an apple tree among the trees of the forest is my beloved among the young men. I delight to sit in his shade, and his fruit is sweet to my taste. Let him lead me to the banquet hall, and let his banner over me be love. Strengthen me with raisins, refresh me with apples, for I am faint with love. His left arm is under my head, and his right arm embraces me. Daughters of Jerusalem, I charge you, by the gazelles and by the does of the field, do not arouse or awaken love until it so desires. Listen, my beloved, look, here he comes, leaping across the mountains, bounding over the hills. My beloved is like a gazelle or a young stag. Look, there he stands behind our wall, gazing through the windows, peering through the lattice. My beloved spoke and said to me, "Arise, my darling, my beautiful one, come with me. See, the winter is past, the rains are over and gone, flowers appear on the earth. The season of singing has come. The cooing of doves is heard in our land. The fig tree forms its early fruit. The blossoming vines spread their fragrance. Arise, come, my darling, my beautiful one, come with me."
When we gather together to worship, it's not only a time for us to receive a blessing from God, the reading of his word and prayer, but also it's a chance for us to bring our offerings, our tithes and our offerings, also our praise and worship. Join with us as we collect the offering this morning.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a story. This is my song.
Savior all the day long.
Praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. You know, all my life I wanted to be a Heritage Singer, and we have them right here in the sanctuary worshiping with us. I would like to invite the Heritage Singers to come forward and to join us on this last song. You know what it's like. We're singing about heaven. We're singing about a time that will be so sweet. In the sweet by and by. And if you want to tap your toe, if you want to put your hands together, join us as we sing.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. For the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place.
Come on, everybody, sing now.
In the sweet. Shall sing on that beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more, not a sign or the blessing of rest.
Here we go.
In the sweet.
For prayer this morning. Creator God, of all the heavens and the earth, and of each one of us, Lord, it is to you that we come to worship this morning. It is because of who you are, your greatness, your power, your mercy, and your grace that we are even here. Lord, our heart's desire is to know you. We lay our hearts before you this morning, and we just ask that your Holy Spirit would fill us to overflowing. We each have a story, a life story, a story of just this past week. And Father, we lay everything before you, our joys, our celebrations, our sorrows, our tears, our hopes, our wants, everything, Father, we give them to you because we know ultimately you have our best interest in mind. And Lord, we know that you will answer. We know that you will hear, and you will do according to what is best for each one of us. And for that, we are so grateful. As we continue with our worship, Father, I just pray a special blessing on Pastor Randy as he brings us a message that deals with relationships. Father, that is of you. Relationships are of you. So I just pray that your Holy Spirit would speak through him and bless us all. We ask for your mercies, and we thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day. In Jesus' precious and holy name, amen.
Yeah. I'm delighted that Camp Meeting 2017 has arrived. Delighted to have you here with us and look forward to the next several weeks together. When the decision was made, and I was a key person in making that decision, to focus on Song of Solomon back some months ago, it seemed like such a good idea. And now it has arrived. It didn't seem like such a good idea this week. But of this I am convinced. Many of our relationships are not what they could be. Many of our more intimate relationships, even if you're talking about dating or engagement, but especially if you're talking about marriage. Take, for example, the pastor and writer Timothy Keller. Keller tells about the experience of going to New York City to plant what would become Christ Redeemer Presbyterian Church. He knew it would be a tremendous amount of work, and so he and his wife Kathy made an agreement. He said to her, I need about 3 years. 3 years of long hours, of deep commitment, of frustrating times. If you can give me about 3 years, then I'll be able to back off some and focus more on our marriage relationship. Well, Kathy agreed to that. She believed it was a deep call in his life, and she was ready to support that vision. Well, you know what happens. Life happens. The 3 years came and went, and he said, I just need a couple of more months. And then a couple of more months went by, just maybe two or three more. And the months continued to pass. Till one day he came home. I want to read it to you in Keller's own words. He writes, one day I came home from work. It was a nice day outside, and I noticed that the door to our apartment's balcony was open. Just as I was taking off my jacket, I heard a smashing noise coming from the balcony. In another couple of seconds, I heard another one. I walked out onto the balcony and, to my surprise, saw Kathy sitting on the floor. She had a hammer, and next to her was a stack of our wedding china. On the ground were shards of two smashed saucers. What are you doing? I asked. She looked up and said, you aren't listening to me. You don't realize that if you keep on working these hours, you're going to destroy this family. I don't know how to get through to you. You aren't seeing how serious this is. This is what you're doing. And with those words, she brought the hammer down on the third saucer. I sat down trembling. I thought she had snapped, lost it. I'm listening, I said. As we talked, it became clear that she was intense and laser-focused, but she was not in a rage or out of control emotionally. She spoke calmly but forcefully. Her arguments were the same as they had been months before, but I realized how deluded I had been then. There would never be a convenient time to cut back. I was addicted to the level of productivity I had to achieve. She saw me listening for the first time, and we ultimately hugged. But finally, I inquired, when I first came out here, I thought you were having an emotional meltdown. How did you get control of yourself so fast? With a grin, she answered, it was no meltdown. You see those three saucers I smashed? I have no cups for them. The cups have been broken for years. I had three saucers to spare. I'm glad you sat down before I had to break any more. Have you been at that place where Kathy was that day, thinking there has got to be more to it than this? There has to be more to a relationship. You might even be in a dating phase or an engagement phase, but certainly in a marriage phase. There has to be something more. There's got to be a better way to deal with conflict, a better way to communicate, a better way to share life together, a better way to experience passion. There must be more. By the way, on that last one, somebody will probably push back and say, well, no, wait a minute. The passion, that's going to take care of itself and die out pretty soon. In fact, you might say, I even have science to back that up. And it is true. Scientists are now studying what happens in the human brain when there is attraction, when we fall in love. For example, some scientists at a university in Italy have discovered a spike in what they call the nerve growth factor, NGF. They say if we track that in people who have just fallen in love, there's a decided spike that will last for up to a year, but ultimately it tails off and recedes back to normal levels. Other researchers will say, we have interviewed 5,000 couples, one poll says, 5,000 of them, and discovered that while there's an initial spike in the excitement in the marriage, over a period of time, it tails off. In fact, about 3 years in, you hit the peak of frustration. He's leaving his clothes scattered everywhere. She's not doing what he expected she would do. And there's frustration and a loss of passion. So maybe you say to me, yeah, maybe there should be more passion, a better relationship, but I don't know if that's possible. And furthermore, Randy, you might say, we're in church. What kind of place is church to talk about passion? Please, that's the wrong place to talk about it. We need to focus on that somewhere else. And initially, I might agree with you. I might think certainly God cares about those facets of our relationship that are important in terms of keeping relationships healthy, cares that we resolve conflict in a healthy way, that we communicate at a deep level, that we remain faithful to each other, that we enjoy life together. God cares about all those things, but passion? Does God care about that? A husband and a wife plan a weekend getaway. He buys two tickets to a musical he knows she will love. And he smiles. She buys a nightie she knows he will love. And she smiles. Does God care about that? A young man on a date looks into her eyes. He can feel the butterflies in his stomach. His knees have grown weak. He's going to kiss her for the first time. Does God care about that? A woman slips furtively into Barnes & Noble and picks up a romance novel. She knows it's trashy. She knows that. But she's missing so much of that romantic passion that she just wants to read. She desires more. Does God care about that? A medical student goes walking across campus, earbuds in, on his way to class, listening to the latest love song. He listens to the lyrics that pull and tug at his heart. He thinks, if I could just get through these first 2 years, maybe I could have enough time to focus on developing this kind of a relationship. Does God care about that? We know He cares about all other kinds of aspects of our relationships, but passion, does it matter to Him? Well, as I said, this month, in the first month of September, we're going to the Song of Songs. I'm not even going to ask you to turn to the Song of Songs this morning because it'll take too long to find it. It's tucked somewhere there in the Old Testament between that rather grim book called Ecclesiastes and that gospel of the Old Testament named Isaiah. There it is. We've read it very seldom. We've understood it even less. I'm not going to ask you to turn there. In fact, I'm not going to ask you to turn there because today's passage is so brief, so short. But I will say this. Throughout this coming month, we're going to turn there again and again. And so today we begin with Song of Songs, chapter 1, and verse 1. Four words. Solomon's Song of Songs. That's it. Solomon's Song of Songs. Four words. Would you linger with me with those words this morning? Because they have something to tell us. First word, Solomon. Some scholars argue we can't be exactly certain who wrote the book because, after all, the language in the original could be translated the Song of Songs dedicated to Solomon. But scholarship throughout the centuries, including modern scholarship, gives some very sound reasons to accept Solomon as the author, and so we will. That's the first word, Solomon. Who was Solomon? Well, he was King David's son. He was a king. He was exceedingly wealthy. He was a prolific writer. In fact, we know from the writer of 1 Kings in chapter 4 that Solomon wrote 3,000 proverbs and 1,005 songs. A prolific writer. In that sense, a bit like his father. The old English verse maybe explains some of that. Don't know if you've heard that verse. King David and King Solomon lived very wicked lives with many, many concubines and many, many wives. But when old age came creeping on, they had many, many qualms. So Solomon wrote the Proverbs and David wrote the Psalms. Maybe that's why they wrote. They had qualms. But one other reality for which Solomon was known was his wisdom. He was reputed to be the wisest man on earth. And so it was to the footstool of his throne that people came trying to hear the wisdom of Solomon, understand the secrets of life, get a sense of the meaning of the deeper philosophical realities that they struggled with in their own experience. And they would listen to the words that fell from Solomon's lips, and they would change their lives. That was Solomon. So when we turn to this book, Song of Songs, we are turning to the words of a wise and an experienced man who no doubt has many qualms, but out of that experience, he writes, and we are enriched. Four words in that first verse. Solomon's song. Solomon is the first word. Song is the second word. As soon as we read that word, we have a context. We immediately know this is not law. This is not gospel. This is not narrative. This is not epistle. This is not apocalyptic. This is a song. A song is intended to be sung. In fact, after paying attention to the content, as well as the outline, the words, the lyrics that appear in the song, many scholars believe that this was first written to be sung at an ancient Jewish wedding festival. Weddings in that day and time went for 7 days and 7 nights. Family and friends would come together to celebrate. It is believed that this song was written to be sung, so that morning after morning, as the new bride, the new groom, emerged from their wedding quarters, immediately the assembled musicians would strike up their music. The instruments would play in the background. You would hear a soprano voice begin to sing, "Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for your love is better than wine." And then a tenor voice responds and says, "You are beautiful, my beloved, more beautiful than all others." And behind, in the background, in lyrical tones and music, would sing a group of young women known as the Daughters of Jerusalem. It was intended to be sung. That's the second word, Solomon's song. Now understand that theologians and scholars have not always accepted it as such. In fact, if you look at the history of interpretation, you're struck by the fact that one after another read what was in there and said, no. No, we can't have this kind of passion in Scripture. This is an allegory. An allegory about Christ and the church. Because it would be sacrilegious to think of such sensual things in a spiritual context. Spirituality and sexuality have nothing to do with each other. Such has been the history of the interpretation of this song. I'd like to read you something. I've chosen to read this a bit longer than I might normally read. But I thought it captured so well what has happened with the song throughout time. So the words of an Old Testament scholar named Douglas Sean O'Donnell. Listen to what he writes. The near consensus of both Jewish and Christian interpretation for at least 1,600 years was that the Song of Songs is not about human love at all, but divine love. That is, it sings of God's love for Israel and or Christ's love for the church or the individual Christian soul. The reason for this seems to be the presupposition that human sexual love is an inappropriate topic for Scripture. Nicholas of Lyra could speak of the love between a bride and groom as proper, but not the proper subject of Scripture, and thus not of this song. Such fleshly love, even within marriage, has, in his words, a certain dishonorable and improper quality about it. Similarly, Theodoret of Cyrus wrote that those who give the song a corporeal, that is, a fleshly interpretation, have committed an awful blasphemy. This explains why, from Origen of Alexandria to Charles Spurgeon of London, from the medieval mystics to the American Puritans, Christians allegorized every jot and tittle of the song, each thigh and breast and kiss and consummation. For example, one commentator said that the phrase, "while the king was on his couch," referred to the gestation period of Christ in the womb of Mary. And the sachet of myrrh that lies between the bride's breasts symbolizes Christ in the soul of the believer who lies between the great commands to love God and one's neighbor. Is it just me? Or is that a stretch? Would you compliment your child's growing Christian commitment by saying, "You remind me of a sachet of myrrh that lies between a bride's breasts"? Those allegories are orthodox and certainly Christ-centered and thus edifying, but they are also exegetically absurd and potentially theologically dangerous. It is dangerous when Christian commentators, theologians, and pastors think that there's a radical dichotomy between the sacred and the secular. Praying is sacred, kissing is secular. When we believe that sexuality is the antithesis of spirituality and that there's a great chasm between eros and agape, we're in danger of losing not only our witness to the world. What? Your religion has nothing to say about sex except that it's bad? But also vital tenets of the Christian faith, the incarnation, the bodily resurrection, and the new heavens and new earth. Following Marvin Pope's analogy, I liken the history of interpretation to Hans Christian Andersen's children's tale, The Emperor's New Clothes. Just as the emperor's ministers and subjects affirmed that he was indeed wearing clothes when he was not, interpreters kept telling themselves and their readers that the song is solely about spiritual love when it's not. But just as a child saw the reality of the situation, the emperor is naked, so do we see that the characters in the song are naked. They're naked and unashamed. And today we should share their lack of shame. For the song is a song that Adam could have sung in the Garden of Eden when Eve rose miraculously from his side. And it remains a song that we can and should sing in the bedroom, the church, and the marketplace of ideas. I don't know how you would summarize that. If somebody took that rather long quote and said, well, tell me what it means. Summarize it for me. What's the author saying? I can tell you how I would summarize it. I would summarize it this way. God cares about passionate love in your relationship. God cares if you are physically attracted to that person you're dating, that relationship that is growing and deepening. God cares about whether or not you desire your fiancé. God cares about whether or not in your marriage there is a robust and vital sexuality. God cares about passionate love in your relationship, cares enough that when his spirit brooded over the divine word, inspiring Solomon to take quill pen in hand and scratch these words onto a parchment, he composed a song, an ode to passionate love. Four words in the opening verse. Solomon, wise, experienced, inspired writer, Solomon's song. A song that tells us that God cares about passionate love in your relationship. But there are two more words. The opening verse says, Solomon's song of songs. Solomon's song of songs. It's a superlative. It's a way of speaking of the majesty and the beauty, the tenderness and the passion of the song. Best one, it's saying. Now, you will find those kinds of statements scattered throughout Scripture. For example, you will find the statement, King of Kings. It's a way we refer to our Lord, to Jesus. We know that there are other kings, but He is the King of Kings. He's the greatest, the grandest, above all others, King of Kings. You will find in Scripture the phrase, Lord of Lords. We know that there are kings of many and lords of plenty, but Jesus is the Lord of Lords. He's the Lord above every other Lord. You'll find the phrase, Holy of Holies, referring to the ancient tabernacle as well as to the temple, to that space, that sacred space behind the curtain. Oh, there are other holy places in the temple, in the tabernacle, other holy places on earth, but this is the holiest of holies. A superlative way of speaking. And thus, in the introduction to the song, we have the word Solomon's Song of Songs. It's at the top of the charts. The best one. I got to thinking. I wonder through recent decades what the most popular love songs have been. In fact, I wonder what's the most popular love song of all time. So I went nosing around on the internet trying to find it. I found Billboard magazine, the Hot Billboard 100, the organization and the entity that tracks all the music and what are the hits, which ones are at the top. And I found one that advertised the best love song of all time. They did a 50-song countdown. They started all the way when the Hot Billboard 100 began back in 1958 and stretched all the way up to the current time. And there were names on there that many of us would recognize. There were names from back in the day, names that I didn't know and recognize, some of you might. Some that I did, the Bee Gees were on there. There were others. But I was interested in that most popular, the best love song of all time, said the heading. So what was that? I finally got down to the bottom of the page, and there it was, number one love song, Endless Love, written by Lionel Richie, performed by Lionel Richie and Diana Ross, 1981, spent 9 weeks at the top of the charts. Some of you will remember that. I was very, very young. Some of you will remember some of these words. My love, there's only you in my life, the only thing that's right. My first love, you're every breath I take, you're every step I make, and I want to share all my love with you. No one else will do. And your eyes, they tell me how much you care. Oh, yes, you'll always be my endless love. You remember the song. Advertised to be the greatest love song of all time. Well, there is that verse in Scripture, Solomon's Song of Songs. Brief statement by an Old Testament scholar, Jack Deere, who says, as a superlative, the title may mean that this is the best of Solomon's 1,005 songs, or more likely, that this is the best of all songs. In other words, whoever penned those words is making the claim, this is the best song ever written. And what grabs my attention is this. It's a song, an inspired song, about passionate love. I don't know what that says to you. But to me, it says that God not only cares about passionate love in your relationship, but that God celebrates passionate love in your relationship. Doesn't just care whether or not you could describe your marriage in some of these fashions. He actually celebrates when you can. It matters to him. In fact, as I've been thinking about this book and this topic and this theme, it has struck me, it's almost as though there is woven into the human DNA, a need, a desire, a yearning for this. After all, try something. Next time you're in the car and you switch on the radio, don't ask yourself how many of these songs are about love. Ask yourself how many of these songs are not about love. Because that's how many songs there are. It seems like it is woven into our very makeup to yearn for, to desire, and to experience that. Or consider this. I found this not only stunning, but disturbing. Have you read anything about the romance novel industry? Not just in this country, but on this planet? A recent year, the year 2013, the sales of romance novels topped out worldwide at $1.1 billion. Billion. In fact, Harlequin, the largest publisher and sales agency of romance novels, in that year sold, are you ready for this? Worldwide, 3 romance novels every second. Just let that seep down in. 3 a second. 800 new titles every year. So you may ask, who is it that's reading these books? For heaven's sakes, who is buying them? Average person reads about 5 books a year. Those who read romance novels read 1 a week. A week may say something about the genre. 1 a week. Who are they that are reading? 86% are women, 14% are men, between the ages of 30 and 54, college educated, making good money. That's who they are. Now, there are all kinds of reasons for concern about that. I understand that. But just note this. It must say something about that deep yearning in our heart and our soul to connect in a deep, profound, and meaningful way with one other person. In a love where we are fully known. And we come to the song. And God celebrates that. So I guess we have to ask ourselves the question, what does that mean? In practical terms, what does all of that mean? Well, I would say this. Maybe you're a young person dating someone. You've begun to fall in love with this person. There's a lot of good about the relationship. You talk well together. You manage what conflict has arisen well. You have similar goals and values and dreams, similar beliefs that God. You can not only talk together, but you can pray together. But there's just one thing. There's no spark. There's no chemistry. There's no attraction. And you think, you know, if we were married, it would be like a good friendship, but probably not much beyond that. Well, to that person, I would say, remember, God cares about whether or not you are attracted to that person. God celebrates when that fire burns. Or you may be a married person. Honestly, your marriage is in the doldrums. You think we've had our time, we've had our kids, we've had our day. There's more to marriage than sex. So let's just be friends. One of you is not happy. Keeps trying to lure the other, invite the other. Not much response. To that couple, I would say, that matters to God. It matters to God that you have a robust and vital life of intimacy. Or maybe you're in your more mature years. And you think, that's come and gone. I mean, for heaven's sakes, we have grandkids. And if our grandkids thought they'd be horrified. Let them be horrified. You're still alive. God still loves you. Forget all the cultural voices that say, oh, this is only for the young and the beautiful. Grasp the word of God that says, you are committed to one another for life. Enjoy it. Nurture it. Even in your golden years. Because Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived, it is said, inspired of the Spirit, penned a song that became known as the Song of Songs. And in it he says, God cares about passionate love in your relationship. God celebrates passionate love in your relationship. Because of that, I want to invite you this month to read the song, to study the song, to sing the song. Because when you sing Solomon's Song of Songs, you just don't know what God will do with you and your beloved. Gracious God, we thank you that you created us spiritual beings, but that you also created us as physical beings. We thank you that you've created within us a yearning to connect on a profound level, to connect in a permanent way with another human being, and that you care about the quality of that connection. Lord, enter into our lives, our hearts, our marriages, our relationships. Make them all they can be. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.